Welcome back, friends. So in our previous video, we had studied about the types of loading and we classified the loads based upon the time, based upon their cross section into normal and shear forces, then based upon distribution, as it can be uniformly distributed or concentrated or non-uniformly distributed. Then we had talked about the axis, which can be a longitudinal axis, a transverse axis. And after which we talked about how we are going to convert a distributed load into equivalent concentrated load, which will be equal to area of that particular geometry and its location, which is going to be the centroid of that particular geometry. Now friends, in previous video I had given a question also, and one person has asked about lateral axis. So let me explain these things first. So now friends, lateral axis is nothing but the transverse axis, which can also be defined as perpendicular to the longitudinal axis. Some people call it as longitudinal axis also, so there is nothing to worry about that. And then as there is a lateral axis, there is a polar axis also, and polar axis is similar to longitudinal axis. Now if I have a shaft here or a beam, the axis which is along its length, the x-axis, this represents the longitudinal axis or polar axis. So this is our x-axis, and other two axes which are perpendicular to longitudinal axis will represent the transverse axis or the lateral axis. So that is a very basic difference between all these type of axes. Now next one is the moment that I had shown in previous video, there is a correction about that. Okay, friends, the correction is regarding the direction of that particular moment. So we had a force P2 acting at a distance B from the center. Now we have applied two dummy forces P2 in opposite direction so that I can convert this P2 force into a moment. Now if I see, the moment will be created with this force and this force, and its direction is going to be, this will try to move in this direction and this will try to move in this direction. So this is going to be the direction of moment, so anti-clockwise direction of the moment, and this force will remain there. So that was about the equivalent force and equivalent moment of that particular force. Now third one was the problem that I had left, the trapezoidal distribution. So let's see how we are going to solve that. Okay, so friends, in case of the trapezoidal distribution, if I already know the formula of area of this particular geometry and the formula of center of this particular geometry, I can simply say what is the net force and where that net force is going to act. But in case I don't know the formula, what I can do then, I can divide this distribution into two parts. One is this lower rectangle that I have taken here with height h1. Another is this triangle. So the height of triangle will remain this only. So it will be h2 minus h1, h2 minus h1. Now I can, the total area will be area of this plus area of this. So that will give me total force. So the net force is going to be given by A total. A total is equal to A1 plus A2 H1. Now A1 is area of this rectangle, which is simply H1 into L, and this is the area of triangle. So there is nothing complicated about this. Now when we are going to calculate the centroid, so how we calculate centroid? The basic formula for a centroid, whenever we are having multiple processes there given. So what I can do here is total area into centroid of that particular area is equal to summation of all the areas and their individual centroid. Now what we need to remember is all these values x1, x2 and x, they are from single reference point. In our case, we are going to take this as a reference point. Here this will be here and here. That is going to be our reference point. We are going to measure all values of x from this point only. So A1 x1 bar, that is with respect to this. A2 x2 bar with respect to this. We have already calculated total area. So that's very simple. You can put the values for rectangle and for triangle and you will get the value of centroid. So that will be from left end. This is important to mention because whoever is going to see your solution doesn't know from which side you have taken the value. So either first you have to mention the center, the origin, that this is the origin from where I am measuring x-axis and y-axis. And then you can also put this remark there that this value is from left hand or right hand of the beam. Now that was about the previous video. Now let's move in the current video. That the today's video is going to be about couples. So what is a couple? What are the different types of a couple? And most importantly, what is the direction and what is the axis of a couple? Because these things are going to help you in SFD analysis, BMD analysis, and other questions also of solid mechanics. They are going to be very useful whenever you write any equation. Okay. So what is a couple? Couple is basically multiplication of distance and force. So as the name itself suggests, it is a couple. So there has to be two forces here. The condition for the forces are two forces will be there and they will be parallel to each other. This is a must condition. They has to be parallel to each other and acting in opposite directions, acting in opposite direction to each other. What exactly do I mean by that? If one force is like this, another force is like this, and now they are parallel to each other, if there is a distance between them D, then only they can form a couple. Their magnitude has to be same, they has to be parallel to each other and opposite in direction. So what will the direction of this particular couple? It is equal to a couple of magnitude P into D, and its axis is vertical axis. How did I get the axis here? This is trying to rotate it into this direction. This is trying to rotate it into this direction, and that gives me a clockwise direction for the couple here. Now, what is the distance that we use to calculate the couple value? Distance is perpendicular distance between these two forces. So I cannot take a distance which is inclined. I have to take a distance which is perpendicular between these two. Okay. Now let's take an example here and we'll understand what different types of couple can generate into a figure. Okay. So friends, as we see these forces acting along different axes, along x-axis, along y-axis and along z-axis, we see that they are going to form a couple in different directions. Now I will take them individually. Let's take the force which is acting along x-axis. So I am taking a front view here. Front view will say there is a force P1 acting here, there is a force P1 acting here, and these forces are along x-axis. So it is very easy to visualize here that their couple is going to have a axis along z-axis. Okay, so P1 into D will be along z-axis. That is very simple. If I take the top view here, or say if I take the front view itself, but I take the forces that are acting in this direction. So there is a P3 this force is trying to make it go in this direction, and this force, the another P3, is trying to bring it into this direction. So that is a couple getting generated along x-axis. I hope that is clear. This is a couple P3 into the distance between P3 that is along x-axis, along the longitudinal axis here. Okay. Then again, if I take the P2 here, P2 will be giving me same result as that of P3. So the force is P2 will be having a couple. Now this is trying to push it here and this is trying to pull it from here, and the couple will be generated which will be having an axis along x-axis. You can visualize it by rotating your hands using right hand thumb rule, and you will find that it is the axis along z-axis. P2D is along x-axis, I can say x-axis. So here we have seen that the forces are either generating the couple along z-axis or along x-axis, and there if I change the direction, it can also be possible along y-axis also. Now we will classify them based upon their axis. What is the possibilities for the classification? The axis can be a longitudinal axis, in our case it is x-axis, or it can be transverse axis or the lateral axis. So whenever the axis of couple is along the length, along the longitudinal axis, it will be called as torque, and whenever the axis is transverse, it will be called as moment. I hope that is clear here. Now if I see the type of forces that were acting here, the forces which were generating torque, those were P2 and P3, and you can very well see that P2 and P3 both are shear forces. So in case of a torque, it is always going to be shear force, and in case of a moment, it is always going to be a normal force. So the normal forces will give rise to a moment, and the transverse forces will give rise to a torque. Now let's take torque and moment into detail, and we'll see how these two are different from each other. Okay, so friends, in order to see in the difference between moment and torque clearly, I have taken the normal forces here, P1, as we have discussed, and the shear force is P3 here. This P3 is going to give rise to a torque along x-axis. You can see it very well. It is going to give rise to a torque along x-axis, and the normal forces P1 are going to give rise to a moment along z-axis. Now that is important. They are going to give rise to a moment along z-axis. So what is the basic difference between moment and torque is regarding the axis. For a moment, axis is always transverse. It always acts along transverse or the lateral axis, but the torque always acts along longitudinal or the polar axis. That is the main difference. So in case of moment, it is going to be either y-axis or z-axis, and in case of torque, it is always going to be x-axis. Now the plane in which that couple is going to act, this couple of P3, this is acting in the cross-sectional plane B, D, G, F. This will always act in this plane only. So for a torque, the plane is cross-sectional plane. So either in the cross-sectional plane or a plane parallel to cross-sectional plane. But moment, the moment of these two forces is acting in plane A, B, C, D. A plane which is parallel to A, B, C, D. So this will always act in a plane perpendicular to cross-sectional plane. Now that is important here. Next one is the effect of moment. What will be the effect of this moment? As we can see, this upper force is trying to compress it here, and this lower force is trying to extend it from here, and this will basically result in this type of situation, that the lower part will get extended and the upper part will get compressed. That is the basic effect of moment, which is known as bending. The beam is getting bent here, and this is bending along z-axis. This is important, bending along z-axis. If I change the direction of forces, it may bend along y-axis also. Now the effect of torque will be, this plane is here. All right. Now this plane is going to feel a shear effect. Okay, this force is trying to push it here, and this force is trying to pull it from here, both P3 forces, and this is going to get a shear effect here. Now that is the difference of effect between moment and torque. Then we also consider the moment of inertia. Moment of inertia in case of torque, so we always take the moment of inertia along the axis which is for the couple, same axis only. So moment of inertia for torque will be along x-axis, that is the polar moment of inertia, in case of bending or in case of moment. Now since this bending is along z-axis, so moment of inertia here will be along z-axis. Now there can be a possibility that we need to take the moment along y-axis also. Let me explain that also here. Okay, so let's consider these two cases here. In first case, see, in both cases the force is acting normal only, it is along x-axis, so it is going to give rise to moment, there is no doubt about that. But in first case the couple is forming along y-axis, means it will be in the plane A, B, C, D. The couple will be along the plane A, B, C, D. But in this case, the couple will be parallel to the plane A, E, F, B, because the forces are acting along z-axis. That is the main difference here. The axis of moment in this particular case, it is z-axis. But axis in this particular case, it is y-axis. So you can see here the bending is going to be such that ABCD plane, it is getting compressed. So it will get something like compressed if I see it from the front view. And this part, this CHDG, this is going to extend. So it will form something like this. So that bending, where this is along Z-axis. But in this case, ABCD, this is going to get, so I will have to make the 3D figure here for you to understand it better. ABCD, this plane is getting stretched. Okay, now plane ABCD, this particular plane is getting stretched, ABCD, and this plane, the plane behind it, that is getting compressed. So plane EFGH is getting compressed. Okay, so this plane will get compressed. So that sort of bending will take place in this case, while here it is like this. So I hope you are getting the point. This bending is along this direction, which is y-axis. Here it is bending along this direction, which is z-axis. So in this case, since the bending is along z-axis, we will take izz for our analysis. In this case, we will take iyy for our analysis. It's as simple as that. Okay. Now let's consider a circular shaft also, and we will finish the topic of moment and torsion there. So in case of a circular shaft, if the forces are acting like this, one P force here and another P force here, that is a tangential force. So this, again, the force is in the cross section, the couple will be in the cross section, and its direction is going to be along the pole of this particular body. So this P will give rise to torque here, this will convert into a torque. Now if the forces were something like this, there were a P1 here and P2 here, a P1 here, so that will tend to bend this particular beam. So this P1 will give rise to moment. Now also one more thing, whenever there is a bending because of moment, it can be in two possible directions. I am taking only the front view here. So it can be a bending like this, or it can be a bending like this, depending upon the direction of moment here. So this particular bending is called sagging. The beam is getting sagged down, and this is called hogging. The beam is rising upwards. So that is the basically types of moments and bending. It can be sagging moment, it can be a hogging moment. Now that was all about the couples. There is one more thing regarding moment and torsion here. We will mostly have cases where, let's say, there is a beam and it is resting on two supports here, and there are several forces here, let's say P1, P2, P3, and so there are two reactions also here. So whenever we need to write the bending moment equation at any given point, at any location. So let me take the location here. Let me take the free body diagram first. I will put up the reactions R1, P1, P2, P3, R2 and R3. Okay. Now what you need to remember is moment is R cross F. It's a vector product of R and F. Now this is important here. This is R cross F, not F cross R. That you have to always remember. R cross F, vector product. So if I am going to write moments about this point, point A. So for this particular force P1, what is R here? R vector. This is my R vector. And what is the force vector? This is my force vector. So the moment because of P1, it is going to be clockwise. This is the direction of the moment. But when I talk about P2, so this is my R vector. From this point to this force, my R vector, and this is my force vector. R vector cross force vector, that is going to be anticlockwise. So the moment because of P2 is going to be anticlockwise here. Now I hope you understood this, but if I write the moment about point B with respect to force P2 only, at point B the R vector will be this. This is the R vector and this is the force. This is R vector, this is the force. So the moment getting generated is clockwise. So with respect to B, moment of P2 is clockwise. Now that you have to remember, that it's R cross F. If you have any confusion, always first go in the direction of R, then twist your fingers in direction of F, you will get the direction of moment here. So friends, that is basically all about moment and couples. Now in the next part, we are going to discuss about the derivation of pure bending, pure torsion and pure axial force. And that is going to help you actually. If you understand the derivation, you will get a few concepts there. If you not understand the derivation and if you skip the derivation, that is also okay. In that case, you will simply have to remember the formulas. Okay, thank you. Thank you for watching. I hope your preparation is going very well. And friends, in case